coming to the concluding parts, I'm going to talk for a couple of minutes a little bit more about the history of the Pennsylvania Fish and Boat Commission. Then we're going to hear from some young staff people about the future of the agency, and then conclude with a short video about the commission. Nice fish. You might be wondering what I mean when I say nice fish. There's a play in Brooklyn right now, an off-Broadway play, in an old theater called St. Anne's Warehouse, right underneath the Brooklyn Bridge. And the play stars an actor by the name of Mark Rylance. Mark is an Oscar-winning British actor who starred in the movie Bridge of Spies. And the play Nice Fish is about two men who are ice fishing on a lake somewhere in Alaska. And the entire play takes place on what appears to be a frozen lake. And during the course of the play, they're talking about life. I won't give away the plot in case any of you want to go to Brooklyn and see Nice Fish. But at the end, they catch a nice fish. And Mark Rylance says to the other actor, he said, you know, he said, I really think that we, man and woman, never knew how to catch fish. I think it's the fish that taught us how to catch them. And that may or may not be true. But whether or not it's true, it's certainly true that in Pennsylvania there is one agency that has taught a lot of people how to enjoy the pleasures of fishing and boating and how to catch a nice fish. And that agency is the Pennsylvania Fish and Boat Commission that we're here to celebrate tonight. I'm going to take you on a brief history tour. The United States in 1866, President of the United States from 1865 to 1869. You may recall that Abraham Lincoln was assassinated in Ford's Theater, April 14, 1865. Andrew Johnson became president. The United States had a population of about 40 million people in 36 states. The American Civil War had just ended. This is what the battlefield at Gettysburg looked like at the end of the American Civil War. The extant dome of the United States Capitol, which has been in the news lately, was being completed. And in fact, that Capitol dome has recently undergone a major reconstruction. And not since this time period has that Capitol dome been reconstructed, only recently. Pennsylvania in 1866, the governor was Andrew Grant Curtin. We've heard his name before. We had a population of about 3 million, and our state capital looked like that. The person who succeeded Andrew Curtin, who signed the bill that created the Pennsylvania Fish and Boat Commission, was Union Major General John White Geary, who took office as governor in 1867. And I mention him specifically to give you a little bit of a sense of what the culture of the nation and the state was like at that time, because John White Geary didn't win election in 1867 by very much. His opponent was a person who was a state senator by the name of Heister Clymer, who ran on a white supremacist platform and got 49% of the vote, as compared to John White Geary's 51% of the vote. As I said, we had a population of about 3 million. So the issue of the Civil War and the separation of the races was still very, very prevalent in Pennsylvania and in the United States. We were a highly industrialized state. In fact, historians have called this period in time, the late 19th and the early 20th century, the era of industrial ascendancy. It was machine politics, mainly the Republican machine. And I'm not making a political statement by saying that, I'm making a historical, factual statement. The Republican Party and certain individuals, mainly out of Philadelphia, who controlled the Republican Party, controlled who got elected to what offices at the local, state, and federal level. And the Republican Party was firmly in control. It was machine politics. Representative Curry, I'm sure, knows something about that. There was the growth of heavy industry. John mentioned the steel mill in Braddock, Pennsylvania. We know that steel, coal, oil, manufacturing, and logging were all becoming very prominent industries in Pennsylvania. In the 19th century, Pennsylvania was the leading oil producer in the nation. Imagine that. Over 30 million immigrants came to the United States. 15 to 20% of them arrived in Pennsylvania, especially from Eastern and Southern Europe. We are becoming an ethnic state. Pete Colangelo's ancestors, I'm sure, can trace themselves back to this time period. State government's role is limited, but it is beginning to grow. One of the first outreach efforts was the creation of the Harrisburg State Hospital for what were then called the insane or the lunatics. It was a common term, lunatic. In 1851, there was a board of public charities created in 1869. The insurance industry, the insurance companies were growing businesses in Pennsylvania, so an agency was created, which still exists, the Department of Insurance, in 1873 to regulate insurance companies. There was a Factory Inspection Act put in place in 1889 to ensure the safety of factories because so many industrial workers were getting hurt and killed on the job in places like steel mills. The Pennsylvania Game Commission was created in 1895, and a state superior court was created that year as well. But there was an environmental impact of all of this industry, and we've already heard about it. I'm not going to go into a whole lot more detail about the environmental impact, but we see that logging had its impact. That's the Susquehanna River jammed full of logs. Over to the far, to your right, you'll see an oil rig in Titusville, Pennsylvania, where oil ran rampant across the ground, and some folks said that the waterways ran black with oil. Coal barges oftentimes spilled their loads or spilled coal, and acid mine drainage was becoming a real problem. So industry was growing, but industry came at a significant cost. There were massive fish kills, declining water quality, concerns over what was called the denuding of forests, mountains stripped bare of their logs, of their timber. What to do about it? Well, as we've already heard, the Act of March 30, 1866, Public Law 336, created Pennsylvania's first fish commissioner, James Worrell, of Irish descent. He said the problems were dams which obstruct nearly all large streams, the lack of adequate fishways, these are his words, the non-observance of the close of spawning season, illegal and deadly devices used to capture and kill fish, such as large nets, the pollution of streams by the deposition of materials poisonous to the fish. And he said that Public Law 336 wasn't enough, so he went to the General Assembly and got them to enact Public Law 887 in 1873, which established the Board of Fishery Commissioners and appointed three commissioners with a $10,000 budget, and they in turn could appoint water bailiffs who were paid $100 a year. Worrell's duties were to, quote, ensure the hatching and propagation of useful tribes of food fishes and to stock and supply all the streams and the lakes and fresh waters of the Commonwealth with the same. Not an easy task. The state soon got into the business of fish hatcheries, but it was helped by private citizens, an individual by the name of Thad Norris. A private individual relocated 450 bass from the Potomac to the Delaware River near Easton in 1870. 1873, a hatching house was built near Marietta. General Assembly provided $5,000 in 1875 for a Western hatchery and quarry, which received its first brown trout eggs from Germany in 1886. In 1879, the U.S. United States Fish Commission provided carp to Pennsylvania, a rarity. 1888, rainbow trout were stocked in the Susquehanna River, and you can see that as the commission, as the agency's work expanded, other hatcheries came online, including one in Wayne, 1903, Union City, 1905, Tyonesta, and Reynoldsdale. The state was getting into the business of hatcheries. Oh, let's not forget that in 1904, 90,000 frogs and 10, I'm amazed by this number, and I double-checked it, and it's right, 10.2 million chain pickerel were stocked. And then the agency got a little bit innovative to patrol Lake Erie. John talked about the polluted Lake Erie. To patrol Lake Erie, in 1907, the General Assembly allocated $6,000 for the building of a ship called, of a steam tug called the Commodore Perry. You see a picture of it there, a 70-foot steam tug, which was launched in 1908. Its captain was Jeremiah Driscoll, whose family was well-known as anglers in the Erie area. Governor Stewart named the vessel after Commodore Oliver Hazard Perry, the naval hero of the War of 1812, and its job was to patrol Lake Erie to make sure that illegal nets weren't being used to catch unduly large amounts of fish, and that various types of waste, including untreated human waste, were not dumped into Lake Erie. I did the actuarial math on this and figured out that the $6,000 that was spent on the Commodore Perry today would be $155,000. So I guess that boat could be built for $155,000 today. I'm not sure about that. The commission also innovated with the what was called the Susquehanna Rail Car, built by the same company that built passenger railroad cars for the Pennsylvania Railroad. It ran from 1892 to 1914. It was pulled for free by the Pennsylvania Railroad with cans of fish to various locales across the Commonwealth to stock the waterways. Now, the reason this had to be built was that prior to it being built, the Pennsylvania Railroad, for free, hauled water bailiffs and cans of fish to various locales in the Commonwealth in passenger cars with passengers. And passengers started to complain that the car stunk. So the General Assembly agreed to allocate some money to build the Susquehanna Rail Car. There were some administrative firsts. The first fishing license was enacted in 1921. $1 for those of 21 years of age or more. It was reduced to age 18 in 1923 and to 16 in 1925. By the early 20s, the commission was fully self-supporting with a revenue of $207,000. A board of fish commissioners was officially titled in 1925, and in 1949, the first executive director, Charles French, was appointed. In 1949, the board of fish commissioners became the Pennsylvania Fish Commission. Its philosophy has been to preserve, protect, and enhance as a public service agency. And I'm going to very quickly do a little comparison. How did the agency preserve, protect, and conserve then, in the past? Well, for example, it enforced a law that forbade the emptying into any waters of the Commonwealth any waste that is deleterious to fish. It enforced a law in 1931 requiring licenses for all motorboats operated on inland waterways. It supported a clean streams law in 1937 that was enforced by the State Sanitary Water Board. Here's something interesting. It enforced a landmark 1942 regulation that prohibited the operation of a motorboat while intoxicated. In the 1950s, it began to apply science and field investigations to examine water quality. It went after polluters, such as the Glen Ogden Coal Company, which polluted the Susquehanna River with acid mine drainage in 1961, resulting in a massive fish kill. And in 1974, the commission was granted protection over reptiles, amphibians, and aquatic organisms. And in 1976, the commission adopted regulations for snake hunts. So that's a little bit about how it protected and conserved then. What about now? To compare, you heard a little bit about the Susquehanna. The Susquehanna River has pollution problems today. The smallmouth bass population has been plagued over the last decade by illnesses and elevated mortality rates. The Department of Environmental Protection has concluded that herbicides and something called endocrine disrupting compounds are the likely causes of tumors on a smallmouth bass that you see to the right. The Fish and Boat Commission has launched the Save Our Susquehanna campaign, which has allocated funding to deal with water pollution in the Susquehanna River. When it comes to boating safety, protecting and conserving now, the Fish and Boat Commission has issued something called Nautical Rules of the Road to give guidance to operators of motorboats, and also requires that motorboat and personal watercraft operators complete educational programs and possess certificates of boating safety, and that they've completed certain educational requirements. There has been tremendous improvement in hatchery management that there's a good deal. You'll have to read the book when it comes out to learn more about hatchery management. But I know Brian is here from the Belfont Hatchery, and he knows a great deal about it. But essentially, there has been methods put in place to deal with the effluent or the water that comes out of hatcheries so that there aren't problems as there used to be with things like food that wasn't consumed or fish waste. In fact, between 2007 and 2010, there was an average decrease of 50% in the total amount of suspended solids released into the aquatic environment downstream of several hatcheries in Pennsylvania. And the Fish and Boat Commission is also part of the Unassessed Waters Initiative, which is a partnership between volunteers and a variety of professional organizations to assess the quality of the water of some of the 86,000 miles of streams that we have in Pennsylvania, a lot of which haven't really been assessed. Well, how did the agency enhance then? You see some examples here. I think for purposes of time, I'm not going to go through each of them. But muskie eggs were hatched. Pennsylvania Angler as an educational tool was launched in 1931. Various types of fish were hatched and distributed throughout the Commonwealth. Regional fishing and boating schools as educational programs were implemented in the 50s and the 60s and continued into today. And in terms of enhancing now, well, we live in a TGIF world. What I mean by that is that we live in the world of Twitter, Google, the internet, and Facebook, a TGIF world. And the Pennsylvania Fish and Boat Commission, over the past 10 to 12 years, has engaged all four of these types of technology. Its web page is full of information about all kinds of programs dealing with boating and fishing, as is its Facebook page. The Fish and Boat Commission's website says simply, throw in a little fishing, wildlife watching, and camping, and you can see how water works wonders in Pennsylvania. And accessing that technology that's out there from the Fish and Boat Commission works wonders. There's a variety of educational programs that we're going to hear about from our next group of speakers, including boater and angler education programs. We heard about the mentored youth program. We heard about the the tackle lumber program, Pennsylvania Angler and Boater obviously is an educational tool. It enhances today through the dedication and professionalism of its staff. And I think you saw that here tonight. There's probably not much more that I really need to say about that. Although I did have some prepared remarks about that, with the exception that the titles have changed over the years. We no longer have water bailiffs. We have waterways conservation officers. We have professional educators. We have people who work in marketing and outreach and other, and certainly the technical positions, the scientifically technical positions that are prevalent throughout the agency. So the professionalism and dedication and expertise of its staff is a way that it has enhanced itself now and enhanced its work to the public. In terms of water quality, the struggle continues to maintain clean water in Pennsylvania. John talked a good deal about the progress that has already been made, and there's more that needs to be done, such as the Save Our Susquehanna campaign. What Governor John Fine in 1951 said this, he said, "Fishing in Pennsylvania will expand and improve as we carry on our fight for clean streams." John Fine said that 60, 70 years ago. Not a whole lot has changed, although some of our waters have been cleaned up. And then there's the theme of the service to the common person. This runs throughout Pennsylvania Fish and Boat Commission's history, that it serves no one special interest. It serves the public. It serves the common person. If you read Pennsylvania Boater and Angler, if you go to the website, if you hear the staff talk about the about who it serves, the agency serves the common person. It has in mind the people that individuals like former Governor George Leader and former Secretary of Forest and Waters and DER had in mind, Maurice Goddard had in mind when they both made it a policy to put a state park within 25 miles of every Pennsylvania, a policy that they put into effect in the 1950s, and which by today has largely been achieved. John Arway's editorials called Straight Talk are about the common person, as were Ralph Obel's columns and writings about the common person. And I would not do this presentation any justice if I did not talk for just a few moments about the legendary Ralph Obel, who served as executive director from 1972 to 1982, and I know many of you know him. Mr. Obel, as many of you call him, had a very impressive background. He was a leader by nature. He was served in the Second World War. He had a commanding presence and a very clear and distinctive voice. And his slogan was, "Do your duty and fear no one. Follow what you believe in and fear no one." And it's those who knew him best who describe him best. And I'm just going to read two quotes from people that I interviewed about Ralph Obel. One of them is Pete Duncan. Pete, are you here tonight? Pete Duncan was the former executive director of the Pennsylvania Game Commission, and he also served as secretary of DER, and Pete's a good friend. Pete said this when I interviewed him about Ralph Obel. He said, quote, "Ralph could be very tough and uncompromising when he strongly believed in something. He could be both a tyrant and he could be very charming. He took a genuine interest in people and he was a mentor to many, including myself. It was not unlike him to send personal notes to people to congratulate them on an accomplishment or to chastise them when he thought they did something wrong. His management style was pick the best and the brightest, trust them, let them do their jobs, and then back them up all the way. He had a long-term vision to sustain natural resources, and he worked with several organizations tirelessly to perpetuate the natural resources of Pennsylvania." Tom Qualter, Sr. Tom, are you here tonight? Tom, when I interviewed you about Ralph Obel, you said this. You said, sometimes when Ralph would receive a call from a legislator or another public official demanding that an enforcement action against the citizen be withdrawn, but he hardly ever conceded to those demands. In fact, I don't ever recall one time when Ralph conceded on an enforcement issue. He was a firm believer in enforcement of the law. Lastly, his son, Ralph Obel Jr., told me this. He said, you know, on one occasion I was very young. We were driving in the family car when my father witnessed a group of motorcyclists discarding empty beer cans along the side of the road. We came to a red light, and my dad got out of the car, walked up to the bikers, and chastised them for littering, and told them to pick the cans up, which they did. With his stern voice, he caught their attention. My dad's reaction made a real impression on me. He just had that type of commanding presence. There's too many accomplishments to talk about when it comes to Ralph Obel, but there's a few there for you to see. He said, as for dreams, let us resolve them into one, an educated public with a conservation conscience. He fought for a law in 1974 that gave the agency jurisdiction over reptiles, amphibians, and aquatic organisms. He collaborated the agency with many organizations, like-minded organizations. He supported what he called the thin green line, the enforcement arm, the green enforcement uniforms of the Pennsylvania Fish and Boat Commission. He spearheaded the shad restoration program in the Susquehanna, was well out in front of the codification of the Fish and Boat Laws, Title 30, in 1980. Spearheaded Operation Future, which many of you know about. Another one of his mottos was resource first. Put the resource first and care for the resource first. And his straight talk articles in Pennsylvania Angler were just that, straight talk. He pulled no punches. He wrote the way he felt, and he implemented Fish for Free Day in 1984. His accomplishments were marked by a Pennsylvania Historical and Museum Commission historical marker just a couple of years ago in front of the Fish and Boat Commission's headquarters on Elmerton Avenue. And when he retired in 1987, he wrote his last straight talk article and said this: it's tough to write this straight talk column because it's going to be my last one. It's natural to leave behind something that is noteworthy and worth remembering. Looking around us, we can find the evidence of a throwaway society. There are those who get a great feeling of satisfaction in feeling that you can afford to throw things away and easily find something better. The expansion of America was seated in such an epoch. I think this is wrong. The unique power bestowed upon each individual human being to do good and to even change the course of history is often underestimated. All the greed and short-sightedness of the exploiters will not prevail if just one individual rises up and says, "Why should we put up with this?" I insist that if one is stubborn enough, like him, he can and will prevail over those misanthropes who were obviously born out of wedlock. Straight talk. The trail will be long and full of frustrations. Good and ill must be accepted together. We have to reconcile ourselves to the mysterious rhythms of our destinies. Rest, cries the chief sawyer, and we pause for breath. Ralph Obel served the common man. And so does John Arway, and so did Doug Austin, and so did Pete Colangelo, and so did the others, all the commissioners now and in the past. Because they've all believed in what we've heard several times tonight, what the people have a right to. Article 1, Section 27 of the Pennsylvania Constitution, that the people have a right to clean air, pure water, and to the preservation of the natural, scenic, and historic, and aesthetic values of the environment. Pennsylvania's public natural resources are the common property of all the people, including generations yet to come. As trustee of these resources, the Commonwealth shall conserve and maintain them for the benefit of all the people. And there are several agencies that do that, including, at the top of the list, the Pennsylvania Fish and Boat Commission. Look how happy that kid is. If the Fish and Boat Commission were to be in no other business, it would be in the business of making people happy. That young man, 10, 12 years old, with a Steelers hat on, by the way, is just thrilled to have caught that rainbow trout. And the agency continues this philosophy, just as it has over 150 years, although it's been stated more in recent times, to protect, conserve, and enhance. That's my not-so-brief history tour, I guess, of the Pennsylvania Fish and Boat Commission. And now we're going to hear for a few minutes from a couple of individuals from the agency about the future of the agency. First, Daniel Ryan, a fisheries biologist from the Bureau of Fisheries. Dan?
Thank you. Hello, everyone, and good evening. My name is Dan Ryan, and I've been employed with the Fish and Boat Commission as a biologist since 2011. So the 150th anniversary year would be my fifth year being employed with the commission. At a young age, I dreamed of being a biologist with the commission. And to prove this fact, I brought with me today a letter. Now, you probably can't see it. It's written pretty small, but I wrote this when I was about 10 years old. My dad recently found this. It's actually a letter to the Fish and Boat Commission requesting a subscription to the PA Angler and Boater, and a poster for warm water game fishes of the Commonwealth that the commission published. And apparently I have the letter because I was too busy fishing and not working, so I never mailed the subscription in because I never had any money. But during my short employment at the commission, I have noticed that cold water fisheries receive much attention, and for good reason. The commission assesses waterways for wild trout presence, monitors existing wild trout streams, stocks millions of trout annually, manages thousands of wild trout streams, protects trout habitat, and undertakes habitat projects for trout and trout anglers alike. In fact, approximately half the anglers in the Commonwealth fish for trout. Obviously, the commission excels at trout management, and trout fishing opportunities are abundant in the Commonwealth. But did you also know that the commission is responsible for managing approximately 228 public lakes, reservoirs, and estuaries, totaling about 435,000 acres of surface water as warm water fisheries? As part of managing these warm water fisheries, the commission implements statewide fishing regulations, stocks certain warm water fishes, installs fish habitat, and develops and enacts management plans to successfully monitor and manage specific warm water game fishes. Luckily, these warm water fisheries are numerous and accessible and are often conveniently located adjacent to populated areas. In addition, the United States Fish and Wildlife Service states that in 2011, the most popular game fishes in the nation were warm water fishes, in particular basses and panfishes. So given this information, I foresee future opportunities for the Commission to further expand upon warm water fisheries management as a complement to the Commission's excellent trout management programs. Perhaps future warm water management strategies may include continued and more consistent partnerships with national, regional, and local fishing organizations to further promote fishing for popular warm water game fishes in the Commonwealth, perhaps even adjacent to populated areas for ease of angler access. The application of future cutting-edge research conducted by academic and governmental agencies will aid commission biologists in the protection of warm water resources from various environmental stressors, as well as the implementation of specific angling regulations for various warm water fisheries. Habitat improvement efforts by the commission will certainly continue to assist and providing much needed habitat in numerous aging man-made water bodies and variously environmentally impacted streams to further conserve warm water fisheries across the Commonwealth. The future of warm water fisheries management at the Commission may even consist of emulating programs such as Kentucky's Trophy Bass Propagation Program to further enhance existing warm water fisheries and angler experiences by stocking popular warm water game fishes selectively bred for larger sizes and faster growth. In short, I believe the future of the Commission will still be to protect, conserve, and enhance the diversity of the Commonwealth's aquatic resources. Thank you all and have a great evening.
And next we have Brian McHale, manager with the Bureau of Hatcheries. Brian?
Good evening. I didn't trip coming up the steps, so I guess that's a win so far. I got my start with the Commission back in 2007 as a fish culturist and moved into the position of a fisheries technician within the cooperative nursery unit in 2011. And in that time with the Commission, I spent countless hours with volunteers, school groups, anglers and boaters, both young and old. One thing is very certain. There's a great passion for angling, boating, and aquatic resources among all these groups. Whether being a group of anglers helping with a stream stocking prior to the opening day of trout season, a group of dedicated volunteers at a cooperative nursery raising trout, stocking them in their local streams, or even a group of school students that I get to talk to when they come through for a tour at the Benner Springs State Fish Hatchery. That passion is always present. The passion our anglers and boaters have is mirrored by those of us that work for the Fish and Boat Commission. Let's face it, we didn't get into the field of aquatic resources to make a lot of money. We do it because we want to do it, because it's our passion, because we love it. One of the best parts of my job is whenever I receive photographs from our cooperative nurseries from their children's fishing derbies. And you get to see the smiles on all the kids' faces. And knowing that those kids are the future, not only of our sport, but our agency. And as a father of two, I see that in my own children. As a child, I grew up in Erie. I was always out fishing, always on the water. And I can remember a day when I was out with my mom. We were actually riding around Presque Isle State Park. I was about 8, 9 years old, and we came across a stocking truck. There was a fish culturist stocking steelhead into Presque Isle Bay. Whether he knew it or not, he had my full attention. And I was watching everything he did, and I thought it was just the coolest thing. And so as fisheries professionals, we need to realize that we have children that want to do what we do. And so when we have the opportunity to educate young people, we should take advantage of that. As an agency, I feel our future is bright. We face challenges along the way, both foreseeable and not. However, we have the staff to face these challenges. We have a great mix of experienced staff who've been around, have seen it all. Don't worry, I'm not calling anyone old, just saying you're all experienced. We also have a lot of young staff, like myself, who are willing to learn, eager to learn, and want to do the best that we can. We all have a common goal to protect, conserve, and enhance, and to provide fishing and boating opportunities. As long as we stick to these principles, listen to the environment, and listen to our boaters and anglers, I'm confident we will be successful in our mission. Personally, I'm very optimistic and excited about what lies ahead for myself and other young staff members. Whether it be an opportunity for advancement, or an opportunity like I have today to speak to all of you. Hopefully in another 50 years, I'll be able to come back for the 200th anniversary as a retiree and get to listen to some young staff members talk about their optimism for the future within the Fish and Boat Commission. And finally, I just would like to thank everyone for the opportunity to speak to you tonight, and I hope that you all enjoy your evening.
And And to give another perspective from a waterways conservation officer point of view, we have Darren Kephart from the Bureau of Law Enforcement.
Good evening. My name is Darren Kephart with the Bureau of Law Enforcement. And it's a great honor and a privilege for me to be here tonight. I want to take just a few minutes and share with you some of my views on changes recently within the Bureau and what I foresee for the future. In an ever-changing world, it's become more and more demanding and dangerous for law enforcement. Physical attacks on police officers around the nation, in our state, and within our own Bureau are on the rise. Interactions with individuals under the influence of drugs or alcohol are also continuing to increase. The senior management staff within the Bureau of Law Enforcement have noticed these increasing dangers and made great strides moving forward in officer safety. For instance, we now have prisoner separation barriers in our new patrol vehicles. We have an increased emergency lights package that's the best I've seen within my career. We have an issued patrol rifle, hard body armor, and an improved defensive tactics program. We're now issued smartphones that allow me to identify a subject, check for warrants, or run a criminal history check. Again, these are all great strides forward in officer safety. So what do I see for the future? Excuse me. What do I see for the future? With our current management staff and those officers eager to take future management positions, they're dedicated, they're motivated, and they're passionate about obtaining the proper equipment and training to lead a force of conservation police officers into the future, where we can even more effectively serve and protect the people and the resource of the Commonwealth, and most of all, bring us home safely at the end of our shift. Thank you.
Thank you, Darren. And Darren's uniform, the green uniform, represents the thin green line that Ralph Abel talked about. And finally, from the North Central Region, from the Bureau of Outreach, Education, and Marketing, we have Amidia Daniel, who is a North Central Region Education Specialist, to give us a point of view from Education, Outreach, and Marketing.
Good evening. How is everybody? Doing good? All right. I'm Amity Daniel, and I'm with the North Central Region office up in Pleasant Gap, and I'm one of the region education specialists that go out and do the fishing programs, the fly fishing programs, work with trout in the classroom. So there's a lot of different perspectives that we have a chance to see throughout our year and throughout our lifetime, and most importantly, to see what I'm going to talk about here, and which are the stories. And each and every one of you sitting here today have a story, and there's a reason that you are here. So with that, I'm going to share a little metaphor with you. And the items that I hold in my hands tonight are physically different, but similar. One is thick, one is paper thin. One tells a story, the other seems to be just a fishing license. For me, and I'm sure possibly many others, the fishing license is more than an object. It is something that embodies cherished moments shared with family, friends, coworkers, home waters, and possibly the fish caught and missed. Yes, we do miss fish, right, guys? It's the beginning of a story. Through this lens, so looking at this through this lens, a license and the ecosystems it supports represent the spine of the book. It is the foundation of the unseen pages that share stories of unique moments experienced within, along, or while traveling to one of Pennsylvania's various aquatic resources. The stories are created by a diverse group of authors, past, present, and future. A few are with us tonight, we hope, right? If you have a fishing license, there is a reason. And because of that reason, you are an author and you have a unique story to share. You have an opportunity to help others begin their story. It doesn't matter if your story is one that includes passive or active connections to the waterways. Your story, if shared, no matter the origin, is important and may help encourage others to initiate their story. My story began with family and friends. My family and friends included me into their stories. Through their story, they taught me the importance of aquatic resources, ways to respect and enjoy them. They also shared that the journey to or along a waterway can be just as exciting as the planned activity. Some of their stories may have been tall tales, right, Paul? But others became part of me. To this day, the smell of wet leaves, the chorus of birds in the morning and spring peepers in the evening, and the sound of water rolling off your rocks connect me back to those moments. It is because of those moments and because of those stories shared that molded my story, and I hope to mold and help guide my children, 5 and 7, to these waterways, share with them the adventures, the treasures, and the importance of those waterways, as well as share it with others along those water edges. Sharing stories now goes beyond movies, on a train, phone conversations, dinner conversations, photo albums at family gatherings. Although these are still effective and important ways of sharing, we also have other opportunities. Today, technology provides us with an opportunity to share our stories instantaneously. We can now share a story as it unfolds by way of phone, texting, Twittering, blogging, Facebook, Instagram, and I just learned something called Snapchat. These tools share our stories through word, photo, and video simultaneously. Sharing verbally and visually in this manner has the capability to emotionally connect, move, or persuade viewers based on your story shared. Now is your opportunity as a license holder, as somebody that really enjoys these resources, to give others a chance to know what it's like to lose themselves along the banks of a waterway, allowing the ropes of daily stress to wash away, to feel the sense of freedom and relaxation from a breath of wild air, to hear nature's chorus unique only to that moment, and of course, to feel the surge of energy as they connect with a fish and commence a dance only the trout or bass or muskie or carp knows the steps to. Currently, you can share your story and see others through Fish and Boat's Twitter account, regional reports, Facebook, YouTube, or by getting out and joining us at any of our fishing programs, stocking days, special events. And you can do this by joining our Facebook page, check on our online calendar, our YouTube account, and most importantly, we have a couple special days coming up. So hopefully you take this opportunity to share your personal story, whether it's going out and catching fish, whether it's releasing stress. This is your chance this Saturday. Take somebody you know that's never been out fishing, somebody that's not connected to those waterways. You have this Saturday, next Saturday's Mentored Youth, and then of course our statewide opener coming up very shortly. And most importantly, remember, in time, the words and numbers upon this license will fade and our body will surrender to age. But if shared, our stories will continue on through family, friends, co-workers, and this agency as it continues to implement its mission. Thank you for your time.
A new book is going to tell the story of the Pennsylvania Fish and Boat Commission, and it's going to be appropriately titled To Protect, Conserve, and Enhance the History of the Pennsylvania Fish and Boat Commission. There are order forms out in the lobby. The book should be available in July, I'm told, and it will be announced in the next issue of Boater and Angler, so you can pre-order the book. Also, as you exit, there are complimentary copies of the Pennsylvania Fishes book out in the lobby, so you can take those with you. And what we'll be concluding with, our last segment of the evening, is a short video about the current work of the Pennsylvania Fish and Boat Commission. Ted?
Americans or settlers often fished to survive. The catch was dried, or preserved with salt and stored to supplement what they could hunt, trap, grow, or pick to help families get through the winter. And historically, boating was primarily a means of trade and commerce. Today, the majority of Pennsylvanians fish and boat for the fun and enjoyment of the outdoors. Recreational fishing and boating can be enjoyed with friends and family, and alongside other anglers and boaters, whether it is to relax in the solitude of time on the water, the challenge of that next catch, embarking on a paddling adventure, or a leisurely powerboat excursion. Today's fishing and boating is about building fun memories. In Pennsylvania, we are fortunate that our aquatic resources provide such diverse opportunities to fish and boat year-round. It's something for people of all ages and all skill levels. And the wide variety of fish species and boating locales found in our Commonwealth means that no matter what kind of fishing and boating you prefer, there are wonderful places to enjoy across the state. As the state conservation agency responsible for the protection and management of Pennsylvania's aquatic resources, the Pennsylvania Fish and Boat Commission wants you to have a great time while fishing and boating, and wants you to know more about what we do to help provide these opportunities. Let's take a closer look at some of the major fisheries that add up to angling excitement and fun, no matter where you live in Pennsylvania. Trout. Sections on Spring Creek, Penns Creek, and Latorte Spring Run are places to try for a wild trout experience. The commission also stocks trout in flowing waters, such as the Yellow Breeches Creek and Pine Creek, and lakes such as Canoe Creek Lake and Poe Lake. Largemouth bass are found in most of our lakes, as are carp and catfish. And among many locations statewide, walleyes and striped bass are common in both Lake Wallenpaupack and Racetown Lake. With yellow perch in abundance in Lake Erie and Lake Marburg. From October through early spring, Lake Erie's tributaries are packed with steelhead. Smallmouth bass are readily catchable in most larger flowing waters like the Allegheny, Clarion, Juniata, Susquehanna, and Delaware rivers. And in many lakes, you'll find bluegill, crappie, and other panfish in abundance. The Pennsylvania Fish and Boat Commission's role in providing world-class opportunities to anglers can't be overstated. Its mission and services ensures that you'll have a fun and rewarding fishing experience wherever you go. The Commission raises and stocks many species of fish for anglers to enjoy. Its network of state fish hatcheries, fleet of stocking trucks and volunteers, and skilled fisheries management are all dedicated to providing stocked fish to provide these angling opportunities and experiences. But the Commission is also involved in habitat improvement, so our native fish species can survive and thrive. The PFBC also works with sponsor organizations, such as sportsmen's clubs, 4-H, schools, and others interested in raising fish, thus creating more than 150 cooperative nurseries which greatly supplement the Commission's trout stocking efforts. And it works year-round to maintain and improve fishing and boating access for license holders who spend time on or near the water to catch fish and catch the fun. One of the ways that the Commission is directing anglers to great opportunities is with its Pennsylvania's Best Fishing Waters program. As some waters are superior to others in their ability to provide a better fishing experience, this program is designed to help ensure that anglers are fishing high-quality fisheries with enough access, that the fish population and waterways location are capable of supporting the increased angler use, and that the anticipated increased use will not bring landowner conflicts or damage to the environment. When you think fishing, you naturally think boating. The two go hand in hand, and the relationship between them shares not only water, but also limitless fun. Boating in Pennsylvania is a year-round activity and includes a diverse array of boat types and places to boat. Owners of powerboats, personal watercraft, John boats, sailboats, kayaks, canoes, and even rafts can find plenty of places to enjoy their boat. So what is the Pennsylvania Fish and Boat Commission's role in providing boating opportunities for residents and visitors alike? Maybe the first thing that comes to mind is its ownership and stewardship of lakes, and its registration and regulatory functions with boating. But there's much more. An ongoing effort is to improve boating access as well as construction and maintenance of boating facilities. And the Pennsylvania Water Trails Program is a great resource for unpowered boats such as canoes and kayaks. Water trails are waterway corridors between specific locations that can be used for both single day and multiple day trips and include access points, boat launches, day use sites, and in some cases, overnight camping areas. Fun fishing and fun boating rely on resource protection and safety. So a critical part of PFBC's mission is aquatic resource management. Recreational fishing and boating cannot exist without knowledgeable and responsible resource management. Through its Board of Commissioners, agency leadership, and staff, the PFBC is committed to this mission for both the Commonwealth's current anglers and boaters, as well as for future generations. What is aquatic resource management? It includes surveying fisheries and waterways, knowing the population, health, and sustainability of Pennsylvania's many fish species is essential to maintaining quality recreational fishing throughout the state. Another part of aquatic resource management is regulatory. Rules, designations, and laws are finalized by the Commission. On the water, waterways conservation officers enforce fishing and boating regulations. Their duties also include maintaining compliance with creel limits and fishing seasons, informing anglers and boaters about boating and water safety, and education about the dangers of and penalties for boating under the influence. Pollution investigations, water rescue and aids to navigation, markers and buoys fall under what PFBC law enforcement provides. Another element of aquatic resource management is species protection, especially with native non-game fish, amphibians, and reptiles, and endangered and threatened species and the prevention of invasive species in our waters. The Division of Environmental Services leads the Commission's efforts in this area and provides permit reviews for future development that may encroach upon a species' habitat. Permit reviews are also part of their roles when it comes to Marcellus shale gas drilling and protection of the aquatic environment. Outreach is an important component with angler and boater education that includes not just boating safety education, but also fishing skills instruction and even a tackle loaner program. The Commission continues this emphasis on outreach with its agency magazine, Pennsylvania Angler and Boater, a variety of free publications, boundless resources on our website, and the two-way connections we have through our social media outlets. It's proven that educated and informed anglers and boaters are better stewards of the resource, both as a responsibility and in the interest of continued recreation for both themselves and future generations of anglers and boaters. This becomes one of the best ways to impart resource management. For the Pennsylvania Fish and Boat Commission, it all comes into focus with our philosophy of resource first, protect, conserve, enhance.
Hi, I'm John Arway, Executive Director of the Pennsylvania Fish and Boat Commission. First, if you're already a Pennsylvania angler or boater, I want to take this opportunity to thank you for your purchase of your fishing license or boat registration. Since the sale of our first fishing license in 1919, the Commission has used the funding provided by the sales of licenses and boat registrations to support our stewardship of the Commonwealth's fish, reptiles, and amphibians. Throughout this video, you've seen how much fun fishing and boating can be. You've also seen the dedication of the Commission staff. Being both your director and an avid angler and boater, I can't be prouder of or more grateful for the great things that our agency does on behalf of the resource, the recreation, and for you, our anglers and boaters. Come on, and join me. Step outdoors and catch the value. And join in the fun of fishing and boating in Pennsylvania.
This evening goes to the Executive Director of the Pennsylvania Historical and Museum Commission, Jim Vaughn, for allowing us to use this facility tonight. Jim, are you here with us? I know he was here earlier. Okay. Thank you. Well, on behalf of the Pennsylvania Fish and Boat Commission and the commissioners and the staff, we hope you've had an enjoyable and educational evening. And have learned about the history of the agency and what the future has to hold, and that you will be boaters and anglers in Pennsylvania. That concludes our program. I know Ted would like the commissioners and the former executive directors and John to come up here for some photographs. As for everybody else, there are refreshments out in the lobby, and don't forget to pick up your free book of PA Fishes. Thank you very much.